Road. I think the main field is coming. Feel the rush and hear the purr of wheels in motion. Well, this is going to be a dangerous move. And he's got this, the best win of his career.
The first professional bike race of the cycling season gets underway here in Adelaide. This is not the Champs-Élysées in Paris, but I tell you what, there's a real Tour de France feel as the Tour Down Under gets underway. Conditions here are seasonably hot. 35 degrees is the forecast top temperature. Not a cloud in the sky. It's hot, but the racing is also set to sizzle. I'm with Phil Liggett, the voice of cycling. And Phil, we have got a big race on our hands.
We have a great race on our hands, not least Lance Armstrong. There are also 23 Australians in it and 133 riders in all. An awesome field.
Well, of course, Lance Armstrong is the big draw card here. Have a look at the people that surrounded him, especially the representatives from the media who were there as he signed on this morning. Of course, there's a big crowd here. They're here to see Lance Armstrong. He's a seven-time winner of the Tour de France, Phil, but of course, we have many Aussies, more than 20 here.
That's right. My favourite, I think, might be Michael Rogers to take it out in 6 days' time, but today it's anybody's guess.
Well, over 6 days of racing, 760 kilometres of racing, can I ask you for a tip on this very, very early part of the race? Who might win after day six?
I go for Michael Rogers. As I say, I think he's got the form. He's had a gold and a silver at the recent Aussie National Championships. He wants to show he's back to his old former self.
Let's not discount Stuart O'Grady and Luis Leon Sanchez. They are former winners. Phil, you have a very good call today. Let's now go to Paul Sherwin, who spoke to some of the riders before today's start.
Lance, you got the criterium out of the way. Now it's the real business out onto the open road, and I think you're going to be a lot more relaxed now.
I hope so. I definitely wasn't relaxed the other day, but it's good to get started. You know, again, you have what I think is going to be fast racing. Even if there's moments where you can chill out and talk to your buddies a little bit, there's still the finish. There's still what we all suspect will be a group sprint. So same things apply. You got to stay out of trouble, stay out of the way, and make it in one piece.
I think the fact that you've finally won the Australian National Time Trial Championships is something that's going to give you a big boost for this week.
Certainly. It's the actual first, as you said, the first time I've won it. I've got 3 world championships to my name, but failed every time and really national. So, it was good to get that under the belt, and I hope it's a sign of things to come.
Many of the world's big riders are here. All of the attention, of course, is on the seven-time winner of the Tour de France, Lance Armstrong. Let's go to the commentary team, Paul Sherwin and Phil Liggett.
Yes, and the heat of the day combined with the hills of the region is going to make this opening stage pretty tough. We've got 2 climbs along the route, and then in the final 20 kilometres back into Mawson Lakes, where the riders see some couple of kilometres after the start, will make it tough. Here we are then in Norwood, and it is an absolutely beautiful day, but Paul, temperatures set to tickle the 40 degrees.
It's going to be a very hot, long day in the saddle for these riders at 140 kilometres, and it's certainly not the flattest route around Adelaide. And of course, I think it's going to be rather testing.
Chance first to see the suburbs of Adelaide here as we ride away from Norwood, because it's 11 kilometres of steady riding under police control. And as you can see, there are plenty of people out to watch the event. Red flag is in now, and the 140 kilometres start right here. And I'm not surprised that these riders are in no hurry to attack the hills. Noticeably, though, it was Lance Armstrong's team, Astana, on the front.
Very interesting to note that they were paying great attention. You can see just over on the right-hand side there, Armstrong surrounded by his teammates, but almost immediately here's an attack.
It's a rider from the Silas Lotto team here, so the Europeans are saying, who cares about the hot weather of South Australia in January? And this is another rider bridging the gap. 2 riders going clear here. This is Andona Lafuente of the Euskaltel Euskadi, and he's a rider from northern Spain. It's a bit chilly at this time of the year. He's trying to reach Olivier Kaiser, who is a rider on the Lotto Silas team, the same team indeed of Cadel Evans, who isn't here this year.
Well, just talking before the start, in fact, to Hendrik Radan, the team manager of Silence Lotto, and he said Olivier Kaiser was the man that he tipped to go out on an early move. He's an extremely strong rider, and one of the reasons he's in the team, Phil, is to ride at the front for long periods of time, for example, in races like the Tour de France for Cadel Evans. So he's a good man for a long breakaway.
Well, if he's planning on staying away to the end, he's going to have to do about 138 kilometres in front here. This is Mawson Lakes, but this isn't the way the rides will come in. in a couple of hours' time as we swing into the area now. There's the peloton. The two riders have scampered away from the field. And this is the sort of sight from the opposite direction, because the riders come from the other direction when they return back after their circuit of the hills. Two riders together now.
Well, they're coming here through Mawson Lakes for the first time. This is where the finish is going to be, Phil, in around about 132 kilometres time. However, it will be in the opposite direction. And at this point, they've already stretched themselves out an advantage of in excess of 1 minute.
Yes, I'm not surprised, really. Two riders that won't be on the radar of some of the big riders in the race, so they're allowing them their lead. They're not going to just race off and chase them down. Lance, will you marry me? Well, that would have been lovely, but she never left her name.
Well, I think it was that all of the students from UniSA have left that message out there for Lance, so pick any one of the lottery, I would have to say.
Well, the University of South Australia and that rider in the centre with the white jersey, looks like Scott Davis, they are the riders on the UniSA team. All of the rest of the teams in this race are the Pro Tour Circuit teams. The 18 top teams in the world are here on the roads of South Australia.
Also in the second line there, I noticed Robbie McEwen, the winner of the Cancer Classic just on Sunday night, and Stuart O'Grady riding very close to the front end of the main fielder, a local boy.
All looking a little bit relaxed now. One or two teammates of the riders who are up front trying to slow down and break the attention of the peloton, who will be in no hurry here because we're heading out towards One Tree Hill and onto Gould Creek. And that's the first challenge of the day at 39 kilometres. And they're just going to let these boys dangle out there. The lead has already shot up now to over 2.5 minutes. And as you can see, these riders are not too interested. Here's the two leaders being led at the moment by Olivier Kaizen and Lafuente. And Don Lafuente is the other rider.
Well, these riders know, Phil, on a long breakaway like this, if they want to have any hope at all of winning the first stage of the Tour Down Under here, what they have to do is build up a lead of in excess of 10 minutes.
This is One Tree Hill, 30 kilometres covered. The lead is now over 5 minutes. So clearly they're going to let the field dangle away at some, probably 3.5 kilometres behind right now. This is the first sprint. And not surprisingly, they're not interested in the sprint. Now, quickly to explain, small time bonuses for capture here. 3 seconds for the first, 2 seconds for the second, 1 for 30. It might be important later on. 3 seconds going to Kaizen, and Lafuente not challenging him. I think he'll be a better climber, the man from Northern Spain.
I think he will, but this man is the man who's the powerhouse of the breakaway, Olivier Kaizen. But Race Radio, in fact, now telling us there's a lone breakaway from the front end of the main field, and in fact, Will Walker has slipped off the front end of the pack.
There's the main field. They're speeding down the hill here. They'll be hitting speeds around 65, 70 kilometres an hour. But really in no hurry at all. They are now in the streets of One Tree Hill, and the gap is still counting. 5 minutes has passed by since the two leaders went through. And, is Lance welcome in South Australia or not? These banners are all over the place today. Go, Lance!
In fact, at the start this morning, I saw the Lone Star of Texas. The gap again, Phil, extending out to 6 minutes and 40 seconds. We're on the very fast part of the course here. In fact, the next point is going to be the climb at 39 kilometres of Gold Creek.
These beautiful roads that are made for bicycle races here. This is the home of the Australian Institute of Sports, where their top riders have trained many long hours on these roads. Many of those Australians are in this pack today. There are, in fact, 23 Australians and 110 foreign riders in this field. It's the most international cycling field you'll ever see in Australia. There's the two leaders. They're on the climb here of Gould Creek. 39 kilometres is in under the wheels, and huge crowds, and what the reporter telling us, they're even bigger on Checker Hill, which is about 25 kilometres ahead of these two.
Just look at the way the riders are pedalling. The cadence of the way the riders are pedalling here just indicates how steep that hill was that they went up just a few moments ago. There's the top of the climb, and it goes to Spain on this occasion. Euskaltel, Euskadi and Andon Lafuente gets maximum points in the KOM.
I think that was to be expected. The lead, 6 minutes and 40 seconds. So as they continue to keep their rhythm here, they've got a long way to go. Andoni Lafuente and Olivier Kaizen still well clear of the field here by almost 7 minutes, and the field, as they tour through the Adelaide Hills, under no pressure at the moment. They're waiting to see, I think, just how Checker Hill, which is the steepest climb of the day, affects those two leaders.
You may well just see that the winds are starting to buffet the trees a fraction there, and I would say, Phil, that the length of the main field there is an indication that they're actually starting to take that breakaway a little bit more seriously.
Well, this is the beautiful area of the chain of ponds. It was established back in 1864, and a glimpse there of the vineyards, the boutique wineries, and the chain of ponds wines are well known throughout the world. The River Torrens courses through the middle of it, as it does through the centre of Adelaide. Nice place to be on a very hot day on this opening day of the Tour Down Under. And here now are the main field and Saxo Bank, which is being led here by a local boy, Stuart O'Grady. Looks as though they're beginning to whip up the speed.
When you see the line of the main field starting to stretch out like this, you realise the indication that these boys are taking this very seriously. The man right on the front there, though, is from Team Columbia, and that was Bernard Eisel.
Back with the two leaders here as they're heading up towards Checker Hill now. We have spotted from the helicopter an enormous crowd, and now you can see it for yourself because this is halfway up the climb. Not a long climb, but very steep, Paul.
Very nasty, a real sting in the tail because it's one of those horrible climbs. And if you just look at the cadence that the riders are adopting now, you can see and get some kind of indication of how steep this climb is. There's the main field. All over the road right now, they realise this is one of the strategic points, not where you're going to win the Tour Down Under, but if you get caught at the back, you could certainly lose it.
That's right, and the teammates blocking the road here as they course along. They'll make a sharp right turn to get onto that climb of Checker Hill. They're still approximately 3 kilometres behind the two leaders who got together 3 kilometres in. Now you can see just how hard this hill is, and it bites back. And I think, Paul, we will probably see the rider on the right here, the Spanish rider, go forth and claim the points. He'll be our first leader in the King of the Mountains.
Yes, definitely. The team in orange is renowned around the world and in all the Grand Tours of being the team of the mountains and, of course, the team of the attackers. And I feel certain that the man of orange in Euskaltel Euskadi colours there, La Fuente, will get himself maximum points. The main field now turning onto the start of the climb themselves. I did notice Astana had a number of riders right at the front end of the main field in about fifth or sixth position, Mr. Armstrong himself.
And that's where you need to be on a corner like that. Checker Hill was in on the very first Tour Down Under 11 years ago. It's been part of the classic course on many occasions. And as the field start the climb, these two are about to pop over the top. Then there's a very sharp drop off the top. Look at this crowd. We could be on Alpe d'Huez just now in the Tour de France.
Could very well be the Alpe d'Huez of the Tour Down Under here this afternoon. Kaiser not taking too much interest at all, Phil, in trying to get himself King of the Mountains points. When you get into a long breakaway like this, you actually try and work together as a team, as if you were on the same team, because two riders working together has much more of a chance of survival. But just have a look at this. Just look how difficult it is through the heat of the haze this afternoon.
Maximum points for Antonio La Fuente. He becomes the first leader of the Tour Down Under. He'll be in the King of the Mountains leader's jersey tomorrow, if it's not the Oka leader's jersey of the actual tour. Now a chance for a breather as they start to speed down to the bottom where they'll turn right and head towards Gawler.
That's when I think the main field will start to whip up the organisation. The main field now on the early slopes here of Checker Hill. You can see the riders picking their way through the crowds, and I'm sure many of the Europeans on the big teams from all around the world, Phil, this afternoon are going to get quite a shock with this crowd.
Well, I reckon these riders have got to be impressed today. It's looking a bit parched here. Some rain would be very welcome. A third place finish there, and that looks to me as though it was probably Simon Clark who scored well on the right. Another one of the Australian young bucks here riding for the UniSA who's got over there in a vital third place. The peloton went over the line. They're 4 minutes and 34 seconds back of these two, who are now being recorded at 90 kilometres an hour downhill.
Well, they had a maximum advantage of 6 minutes and 40 seconds, and the fact that they've actually shaved off 2 minutes on the slopes of that climb is an indication to me, Phil, that the main field now are starting to take this race and this breakaway a little bit more seriously, and I think slowly over the next few kilometres we'll start to see their lead halved and halved again.
Well, so far they've had a pretty favourable wind on their journey from Norwood in what is a circular trip back to Mawson Lakes, where they've seen already this morning. But once they get to Gawler and a steep descent into the town there, the wind will change direction. And the fact that the breakaway is coming down at this stage of the race does not all well for the distance.
Well, Team Columbia, and it's still the big man from Austria on the front end of the main field, and that's Bernard Eisel. ready to take up the pacemaking. Not too far away is Team Rabobank, and there and a few more riders from Team High Road as well, Phil. I think they're biding their time before they whip up the chase.
So Team Columbia are keeping this race in reasonable contact here. They have a plan, and it would be, of course, to get their team sprinter, Andre Greipel, into the first place at the end. Yes, but the official temperature now has shot up to 37.5 degrees Celsius. That it makes for a very, very hot day. For those Americans watching our coverage, that's tickling 100 degrees Fahrenheit right now, as these riders here are beginning to think they've got a chance of catching up. Well, still beneath the hot sweltering sun in South Australia, the peloton are closing in all the time now on La Fuente and Kaizen, who have been away for almost 100 kilometres. The overall distance, let's not forget, Paul, 140 today.
140, the gap the main field is looking for is 305, but it's now started to come down quite dramatically from that maximum advantage of 6 minutes and 47 seconds, and I have to say, Phil, it is looking a little bit tough here. And you can see Team High Road Columbia at the front end of the main field. There's Lance Armstrong right in the middle there with his teammates all around him. He's ridden pretty much at the front end of the main field here this afternoon. He's never really looked any much under pressure at all, but then of course he hasn't yet really stretched his legs in anger.
Well, there we are, just over 3 minutes the gap now. They've been the heroes of the day, there's no doubt about that. They've been sweeping up the prizes along the way. But the question is, will they sweep up the winner's prize in Mawson Lakes? And you've got to be honest, the answer is going to be no, because the big teams have started to keep a steady tempo. The wind will shortly turn against them, all very unfavourable. Well, we're looking down here on the famous retaining wall for the Barossa Reservoir. So we're near Williamstown. This is the Whispering Wall. It is an acoustic marvel, actually. It is said you can whisper at one end of the wall and your friend will hear you 100 metres away at the other end. Unbelievable.
I wonder what the whispering is going on in the main field here this afternoon. Probably most of it surrounding Lance Armstrong. There you can see him, Phil, sitting in fifth position in
this
main
field.
He doesn't look bad at all, but it's the Russian team Katusha who's coming to the front to set the tempo. That tells me Robbie McEwen's keen.
Well, there's no doubt after his attempt around the park in the east end of Adelaide on Sunday where he won, he's going to feel very confident he can beat the same field again at Mawson Lakes. So that's one team that's going to start chasing these two riders down.
That's the complicated thing for these two riders on this breakaway here, Phil. There are a lot of great sprinters in the Tour Down Under this year, and there are only a certain number of stages where they've got a chance to win. So they will ask their teammates as we get closer to the finish to come to the front, and you may well see two or three teams working together to try and pull these two men back into the field.
Well, this is the sprint here in Sandy Creek, 96 kilometres done now. No sprint at all. These boys are sharing out the prizes on the day. Kaizen gets that one, which will give him an early lead in the points competition. And hardly a sprint. La Fuente's concentrated on the climbs today. He'll be the first leader in the King of the Mountains. There's a nice look at Gawler. As any pioneer would have told you, this was the first country town to be established in South Australia. And some long-term residents still remain, with at least one pub in the town reputed to be haunted. Gawler's also known as the gateway to the world-famous Barossa Valley wine region. The riders don't really want to know that right now, Paul, do they?
Well, they don't, but look at this. This, in fact, is a little move coming from Uni SA, and this is Jock Bobridge, who's jumped off the front end of the main field. And, in fact, there's been a split at the front end of the main field, Phil, because Jack Bobridge has gone past De La Fuente. He's gone straight past Olivier Kaizen there as well. This is a young guy who, at 19 years of age, I reckon has got a great career in front of him.
Well, I know over the years we would call that a cheeky move, Paul, but it's a very, very interesting move. This boy, as you say, 19, is a South Australian. He's being inspired by a lot of local encouragement. Many of the riders in this top field would never have heard of Jack Bobridge, but I'll tell you what they will have done in the next 2 years, because he is a most aggressive rider. Two national titles to his credit a week ago, the national time trial, the national road race, all under 23. Now, if they let him go, one of those titles is a time trial championship, he will ride away.
Well, he actually had himself around about a minute's advantage, but you know, these seasoned professionals, they know how to reel a man back into the fold, and it's all over for Bobridge there. He's back in the peloton. We'll start to see the teams now, Phil, getting themselves organized, getting the chase and the lineup for the final sprint. And I wonder which way it's going to be. I'm sure all of the Australians will be looking for the win this afternoon. Graham Brown is in great form. We've seen him riding well. So too is Robbie McEwen. We saw him win the Cancer Council event on Sunday night. But it's Team Columbia High Road on the front end of the main field in the yellow, black and white jerseys who are setting up the train.
Well, just look at the movement in the peloton here. We're looking for the right turn as we approach the finish in Mawson Lakes. And the riders here now are looking to guide either Robbie McEwen, Graham Brown or Andre Greipel up to the finishing line, because they're the three big teams and they've come away from this bottom corner. It's a long way up the home straight. They've got to get it right.
They've got to get it right. It's an 800 metre straight. If you go out too early, you'll fade in the final few metres. Now they move coming over right down through the middle, and that's going to be Rabobank, and it's Graham Brown's men.
Graham Brown sitting there, number three wheel, and that's Greipel trying to get on the act as well here now, but the Rabobank boys have got the advantage. Far left as we look here now, as Graham Brown is about to be launched into orbit here by his teammates, but Baden Cook is also getting in on the picture on the centre, and that is Andre Greipel and McEwen on the left of our picture. And the final lead out, McEwen's in a great position, comes in on the inside of the crowd barrier here, being challenged by Andre Greipel, the winner of stage one a year ago, and I think this time Andre Greipel will get his revenge. He takes the line, and you know, Andre Greipel started racing in 2005, the very year that Lance Armstrong chose to retire. He gets his first win of the year.
Well, you can see that. There was a big lead out there coming from Gerrit Stegemans in second position. Robbie McEwen just waiting his time, but look at the men queuing up right behind him. McEwen attacks on the right-hand side, but Greipel comes straight out of his slipstream.
Well, he really is fast here, and he goes over the top of Robbie McEwen, and that is a very fast finish. Baden Cook will cross the line there in second place, and it looks as though Stewie O'Grady has got the third place finish. That's a good start for the two-time winner, but the man of the moment is Andre Greipel.
Andre, in the Cancer Classic, you guys, you tried the lead out, but I think today it was perfect.
Yeah, it was awesome. Before, when we passed the finish, I said we have to wait a long time before we take the lead. And yeah, the guys, yeah, they heard. I said in the radio, now we take the lead, and they did it.
So, as it was a year ago, the first Oka jersey going to Andre Greipel, who last year won 15 races to the end of his best ever season. Now he's got one in the bank. This is the overall situation. Baden Cook sits at 5 seconds, along with Kaizen. Stuart O'Grady, third today, he sits in fourth. La Fuente is fifth. Will Walker is sixth. Armstrong, by the way, 120th. In the SA Lottery Sprint competition, Olivia Kaizen, a clear leader here. He won both the sprints out on the course, ahead of Greipel, La Fuente and Baden Cook in fourth place in that. In the Skoda King of the Mountains competition, Andoni La Fuente won both climbs, so it started off with a nice lead in that competition, 32 points ahead of his breakaway partners, Kaizen's 24, Hernandez in third place in that. The cyclist said best young rider is held by Jacopo Guarnieri, and in the Hindmarsh most aggressive rider, that's Olivier Kaizen as well.
It really was a drama-charged first stage to the 2009 Tour Down Under. Andre Greipel, the big German, well, he picks up his first stage victory, a satisfying result after collecting four stages last year and overall victory. Robbie McEwen, he limped home with a swelling in his right arm, a very damaged arm as well. He collided with a camera being held by a spectator leaning over the safety barrier in the last 200 or 300 metres. As for Lance Armstrong, he came home without incident. Caught up with Phil Liggett, alongside the voice of cycling, is the Prime Minister of Australia.
First of all, what's your first impression of the Tour Down Under? Because I think this is the first time in 11 years I've seen you here.
Absolutely, first time I've been here. I think it's fantastic. Colour, excitement, and Mike here, the Premier of South Australia, has put on a nice, mild day, knowing that he had to try and fry Lance to give the local boys a go.
Well, that was my next question. What about the big man being here, staging yet another comeback at the top?
I think it's fantastic. This is history in the making. This guy's got guts, and that's why Australians like him.
Well, that's stage one out of the way. Make sure you join us tomorrow night on SBS from 6 p.m. for highlights of stage two when the Tour Down Under continues its trek through the Adelaide Hills. Don't forget our brand new website. It's sbs.com.au/cyclingcentral. Until tomorrow, we'll see you then.